I was drawn to the depths of the Kochi Mountains for yet another food pilgrimage. My quest? To meet the legendary Turkey King and partake of a turkey dinner I've only dreamed about. My travels first brought me along the Shimanto River, where I parked at a warehouse surrounded by a dark forest. There, various people began to congregate, a couple film crews, some nice Japanese ladies, and even a man making documentaries on Netflix, which was a little insane to me. This all low-key sounds like the start of a horror movie. When the time was right, we entered a small family abode, the air smelling sweet of campfire. A Japanese grandmother kindly greeted us and began preparing a turkey in various ways. Some of the turkey was used for turkey soup, other turkey legs were being marinated in a sweet herbal brine, a few other turkey legs were scored, stuffed with rosemary, thyme, butter, and other herbs, and then cooked over a charcoal fire. While the turkey legs roasted cheerfully, we were offered the chance to tour the turkey farm, which I happily jumped at the opportunity. My mission was to meet the Turkey King after all, so of course I must travel to his hidden kingdom. To protect the turkeys, we had to wear special suits covering our body and shoes, as we could potentially bring in diseases that would make the rafter of turkeys sick. Like Knights of the Turkey Order, we donned our hazmat suits, wrapping plastic bags around our feet. Then, we set off to see the turkey coop. It was about what you'd expect it to be, a big barn loaded with turkeys. Water was set up to irrigate them, and of course they were well fed, with massive piles of feed outside. You could hear them in a distance gobbling away. It was kind of unnerving because they would all gobble at the same time whenever something spooked them. After heading back, we briefly got to peek at the facilities where the turkeys would be killed, butchered, and defeathered. It was small, but clean and effective. It always surprises me how brutal butchering is. There is no perfect, mass-produced method of butchering, but the killing of an animal for processing is usually quick and merciful. Morally, you're obligated to minimize an animal's suffering as much as possible, but of course, death is death, and death is brutal. With the tour finished, our group was given our choice of turkey feathers to take with us. They were quite large and soft. I selected one specimen for myself. After being bestowed our feathers, we headed back to check on the food. Within short order, cranberry sauce and American Georgian-style plum sauce was prepared, along with delicious roasted vegetables, homemade rye bread, soup, and of course turkey. Plates were assembled and everyone dug in. The plum sauce was very sour and salty, but I liked it. It reminds me of the ume-flavored foods that Japan loves so much. The turkey meat was crisp, but not dry, and packed with flavor. The soup was hearty and wholesome, especially good dipping for the homemade bread. After eating, I was left in a turkey coma and could hardly stay awake for the rest of the event. But just before I fell into a slumber, I met him, the Turkey King. With my remaining strength, I flipped open my phone and got his Instagram, gaining his favor. Now if I ever want turkey in Japan, I have royal permission to acquire it. My quest completed. The A-Jet Surf Camp was a great success. I was the man in charge of the surf schedule, so in solidarity with the unfortunate souls I scheduled for an early morning lesson, I joined them. I met an assortment of characters. Everyone was warm and friendly, if a little bleary-eyed from the early morning start. We slapped and zipped on our wetsuits, and after a brief orientation, jumped into the water. It was a tad brisk from the wind, but the waves that morning were gentle and perfect for beginners. After the surf lessons, I assembled the barbecue. I accomplished this by setting the coals, seasoning the racks so the food wouldn't stick, and fanning the coals in flames. Working with the hibachi barbecues, it took about an hour for them to heat up. To maintain a good temperature, they needed constant attention, so I spent the better part of 3 hours fanning the barbecues so people could cook their food in a reasonable time frame. The optimal barbecue temperature doesn't last very long, so I think people cooking later that evening had to wait even longer for their food, but it's the nature of the beast. I did my best to make it a more enjoyable experience for what it was. After cleaning up the barbecues, I joined everyone around the bonfire with my guitar. I played an assortment of sea shanties, pop music and country songs to the few people around me who would listen until my fingers froze from the cold and I physically couldn't play anymore. Then I warmed myself back up around the fire. I couldn't camp that night as I had to leave to continue to clean the barbecues and then jet off the next morning for a 4-hour drive to rescue my friend from travel-related complications. My AJET partner made sure the campground was picked up and clean. Overall, surf camp was a relaxing and chill experience for everyone. Can't say it was for me, as I was stressing to make sure my job was done right, and I didn't get to socialize too much. But I'd say it's safe to call it mission success. I now have 5 events I've planned by myself or with a partner under my belt. More are always on the horizon. I survived an earthquake with my students, an earthquake simulator, that is. Before I regale you with that story, I'll walk you through that day, cause it's a doozy. Early morning saga was a buzz. I biked down to the docks to join the commotion. I went to a local fish festival and sampled a plate of a classic seared katsu no tataki.
Katsu is a very meaty fish, but it's delicious. These are pretty big slices, but they're manageable. Yeah, delicious.
It's sashimi, which is raw fish, lightly seared over a straw fire and sprinkled with large grain salt. It's a specialty food in Kochi, and nobody does it better than Kuroshio. Nothing like raw fish and onions for breakfast to start your day off right. After enjoying the fresh fish, I hiked along the road, past the Saga beach, and followed the hollow boom of taiko drums up and into the mountains. There, sprawled about a large clearing, was another local festival. First, I got to enjoy a local taiko team performance. They're amazing. Then, elementary school students dressed in fabulous Halloween costumes showcased various hip-hop dances. Also amazing. Man, can those kids dance. After those jaw-dropping performances, I continued to wander around the festival until I bumped into my JTE and our students. We were standing next to the earthquake simulator, and after a hasty, broken conversation with the students, it was agreed we all must go inside the simulator and try it out for ourselves. The shaking was strong, but a level 7 earthquake felt a lot milder than I was expecting. The machine rocked us around for a few minutes, mixing my fish and onion breakfast together. I happily exited and moved on to the rest of the festival, excusing myself from my students, feeling only a little queasy. Full up on festival, I rushed off to attend a Halloween event hosted by my town. Finding an adult Halloween costume in Japan at the 100 yen store is next to impossible, so I ended up jumbling together my various jewelry and jacket, and dressed like a pirate. A very stylish pirate, I should say. When children and parents arrived, we began the Halloween event, getting a brief introduction to Halloween, pumpkins, and the origin story of the jack-o'-lantern. Then we moved on to carving pumpkins, a dangerous endeavor. Children and knives are always a fascinating combination. Thankfully, nobody but the pumpkins were gutted, and everyone managed to construct a spooky jack-o'-lantern. The children happily took home balloons, pumpkins, and candy. Good fun. Even later that same day, I made the journey out to Motoyama, to a place called Mississippi Cafe. It's a warehouse filled with trinkets, pinup girl posters, a homemade theater setup, and various other scattered antiques. It's a unique place. I watched a movie with fellow Jets called Over the Garden Wall. It's an animated series that came out quite a while ago, and is full of humor and subverting expectations. Nearly every plot point in that show is deliberately subverted and subverted again, which makes it fascinating to watch. You can just never guess what will happen next. Finally, I made the long trip home and crashed hard after an exhausting but productive day. And that's just a Saturday. Speaking of Saturdays, another Saturday I went on a hike with my Saga students. It was good fun. The student leading the party had a long stick. He used it as a spider detector. I was thankful, as hiking solo, often it's my face that becomes the spider detector. I got to chat with my JTE and keep the students from wandering off and getting lost. Notable point, my fitness has increased an incredible amount since the last time we did that hike. I was able to do it this year with a weighted backpack and have no issues. The previous year it was difficult for me. I was constantly out of breath and my legs, lungs, and feet burned, and that was without the backpack. This year was no sweat. That's all for now. Take care and be bold.